Good morning. The first item of business is general questions, and at question number one I call Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the consultation on the future of qualifications and assessments.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
Professor Hayward is leading an independent review on the future of qualifications and assessment. To inform that review, a public consultation was launched on the 21st of October and will close on the 16th of December. The public consultation invites views on a range of topics, including the balance between exams and other forms of assessment, and how a wider range of learner achievements can be recognised. I would encourage everyone with an interest to have their say. Professor Hayward is due to submit a final report for ministers to consider in March 2023, and as previously made clear to Parliament, externally assessed examinations will remain part of any new system.
Pam Gossel.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Last week saw the launch of the consultation into the future of exams and qualifications in Scotland. Only 3 of 59 members on the Education Reform Board are teachers, and there are no parent representatives. What assurance can the Cabinet Secretary give that the views of parents, pupils and teachers will not be ignored if they happen to disagree with the reforms being proposed by others?
Cabinet Secretary.
Oh dear, Presiding Officer, I fear Pam Gossel has came to the Chamber with a very great lack of understanding about the education reform work that's going on, because the board membership she refers to is to do with the reform of the 3 national agencies. Professor Hayward's work, which is independent of government, is being supported by an independent review group. That includes learners, parents, carers, education staff and college and university representatives. I hope now that I've clarified that, Ms Gossel will be satisfied that indeed parents, carers, education staff, colleges and university representatives are indeed actually already included.
Thank you. Question number 2, Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support is available to displaced people from Ukraine who are moving from temporary accommodation into permanent housing.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison.
Our aim is to improve the performance of the super sponsor scheme, and this week we published 16 interventions following a review of the scheme. Our aim is to empower those arriving with clear advice, support and improved access to longer-term housing options, thereby reducing dependency on short-term and temporary accommodation. And that's why we've put in place up to £50 million for our Ukraine longer-term capital fund to increase the overall supply of housing stock. This has already provided over £400,000 to North Ayrshire and £6 million to Aberdeen City Council.
Mark Ruskell.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response? I have seen firsthand how communities and local authorities across my region, from Killin to Rosyth, are working tirelessly to try and find long-term housing solutions for displaced Ukrainians who found sanctuary in Scotland. But it is critical that any housing offer empowers our new Ukrainian neighbours to have choices over their next steps. I did welcome the Minister's statement on Tuesday, but could the Cabinet Secretary outline what further support will be made specifically to local authorities like Stirling Council to support the displaced Ukrainians to access that housing, but also critically to coordinate efforts with local communities who also have their own interests and their own efforts in trying to find solutions for their Ukrainian neighbours?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I can tell the member that we have provided £11.2 million of funding to increase the capacity of local authority resettlement teams to support refurbishment of properties and enhance the pace of host checks and matching. And I would encourage local authorities to ensure that they're making full use of this funding. And we're encouraging all local authorities and registered social landlords to consider what properties there are in their area that could be brought back into use, and I would encourage the member to discuss this fund with local authorities in his region to identify opportunities to make best use of the funding. Mark Ruskell also mentioned the role of communities, and I think he makes a very important point. The response, the warm, welcoming response from communities the length and breadth of Scotland has been absolutely amazing. And we want to encourage that to continue, and for sometimes solutions that are being proposed by the community to be listened to and acted upon where that's appropriate.
Question number 3, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it's taking to help GPs manage their workloads.
Cabinet Secretary Humza Yousaf.
Despite the challenges of the pandemic, general practice is being strengthened significantly. We're committed, of course, to increasing the number of GPs in Scotland by 800 by the end of 2027 and making good progress towards that target. We've also now recruited 3,220 whole-time equivalent healthcare professionals, such as community nurses, physiotherapists, into our multidisciplinary teams across practices. Local evaluation shows that the expanded MDTs are freeing up GP capacity. They're allowing a focus on patients with more complex conditions, and it's also reducing multiple appointments for the same issue and associated with high staff and patient satisfaction.
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the answer. Almost every MSP in this chamber will have constituents who are unable to get an appointment with a GP. Instead of helping address this issue, the Cabinet Secretary has cut GP sustainability payments by around £5 million. Considering the tremendous workload GPs are under, how can the Scottish Government justify this?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I remind the member that investment in general practice is going up, not down. We're investing at least £170 million a year in growing primary care multidisciplinary teams. That's up £15 million. From last year, we're supporting general practice, and we know and have heard that anecdotally face-to-face appointments are beginning to increase, but I accept that not to the level that some people would like, and therefore I've asked GP practices that aren't offering pre-bookable appointments to make sure they are offering them. But let me just remind Alexander Stewart, the reason why we're having to reprofile money within health is in large part to respond to the economic incompetence of his party. The health budget is worth £650 million less just due to inflation. Pay rises are way in excess of what we budgeted for because of the Tory cost crisis. So please don't come here and shed crocodile tears about primary care when it is your party's disastrous stewardship of the UK economy that has caused such devastating impacts in the first place.
Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, I have constituents advising me that post-COVID they are experiencing barriers in certain GP practices, only certain, to booking face-to-face appointments because the practice has changed their process to online consultation forms, which is difficult for some constituents to use. Is the Cabinet Secretary aware of this, and would he comment?
I am aware, and I absolutely accept what Christine Graham is saying. And as I said in my last response, I've spoken to both the British Medical Association and also the Royal College of GPs about this matter. But it's also why I came to this Parliament a number of weeks ago to say that I'll personally be in contact with every single GP practice to ensure that pre-bookable appointments are also available, which can help with that face-to-face issue. In terms of the online appointment and online booking, I will make sure that I reach back in to our key stakeholders, like the BMA, like the Royal College, to make sure that those who are digitally excluded are not left out in terms of getting face-to-face or indeed GP appointments.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Presiding Officer. Last week I met with a very respected GP in the south of Scotland, who indeed trains the next generation of doctors. The GP was blunt with me and said that himself and his colleagues are burnt out. The impact of the pandemic, yes, but also the strain that GPs have been under for years. Many GPs are now at breaking point and are seriously considering early retirement, and the Scottish Government needs to show the GPs that they are serious about getting primary care services right. Given the announcement yesterday, does the Health Secretary not fear that this will act as a catalyst for early retirement by GPs?
Cabinet Secretary.
What I would say to Martin Whitfield, and he raises a very important point, when I met with Dr Andrew Buist earlier this week, from the BMA, he was saying similar around GPs' burnout and workload. And that's why it's so important that we continue to invest in the multidisciplinary team model. And let me say, funding for that continues. And that's why recruiting 3,220 members of healthcare staff as part of that multidisciplinary team model will help to ease and alleviate some of the workload from general practice. But can I say to Martin Whitfield, the reason why we're having to reprofile some of this money, which is staying, of course, within health, is to help us to ensure that we can put forward the best pay deal possible for our healthcare staff in these challenging times.
Question number four, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the work of the Women's Health Group, including when it will next meet.
Cabinet Secretary Humza Yousaf.
The Women's Health Group was established in February 2020 to develop a women's health plan. It was disbanded following the publication of our plan on the 20th of August 2021. The Women's Health Plan Implementation Programme Board was established in January of this year to oversee the delivery of that plan. Chaired by Professor Marion Bain, the Deputy Chief Medical Officer, the Board brings together a range of organisations to ensure that the actions within the plan are implemented effectively, along with continued input and influence from women themselves. The Board meets quarterly. It last met yesterday. The terms of reference and other information about the Board is available on the Scottish Government's website.
Kenneth Gibson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. 6 months ago, I was advised that the Government is working with the Scottish Perinatal Network to examine adoption of the placental growth factor test for pregnant women in order to detect preeclampsia, which can kill both mother and baby and lead to further health risks later in life. Such tragedies can now be prevented by using these simple and reliable tests already in use from England to Sierra Leone. Can the Cabinet Secretary therefore advise as to progress in rolling out PLGF tests in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, could I first recognise and record the interest that Kenneth Gibson has had on this issue for not just many months but many years, and progress has been made. The Scottish Government is committed to ensuring that women receive high quality, safe care, including in the diagnosis, prevention and treatment of preeclampsia. While NHS boards in Scotland can already choose to offer placental growth factor PLGF testing, should they wish to do so, we've now continued to work with and progress that work with the Scottish Perinatal Network. We've also approached the Scottish Health Technologies Group, who provide advice to NHS Scotland on the use of new and existing technologies. That group, they started work last month, considering the most recent NICE guidelines on PLGF testing, and will produce an adapted version of the guidance for Scotland with recommendations. The SHTG group has started consulting now with the clinical community, with patients' organisations and wider stakeholders, and that work is expected to be completed by spring 2023. But on the back of the member's question, I will explore if there is any further pace that can be injected into this process, given how important we know these tests can be.
Question number five, Neil Bibby.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on how it is reducing waiting times for child and adolescent mental health services.
Minister Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We are setting the conditions needed for long-term sustainable improvement to CAMHS systems. We saw an 8.6% drop last quarter in the number of waits over 18 weeks. However, I recognise that performance against the national waiting time standards varies across health boards. We're directing tailored support to boards not on track to meet the standard, providing access to professional advice, ensuring that they have robust improvement plans in place, and we are monitoring progress closely. I've also met recently with boards furthest away from achieving the standard to discuss my concerns and expectations for improvement.
Neil Bibby.
I have previously written to the Minister about my constituent John in East Dumbartonshire. John's 9-year-old son has been self-harming. He waited 6 months from referral until initial assessment by CAMHS. He was then told it would be a further year until a support plan was in place. John's younger son is now imitating his brother's behaviour. The entire family are at their wits' end. Thousands of children are on waiting lists, despite the Scottish Government repeatedly promising to fix this. Can the Minister explain to John why children are continuing to wait so long to get the proper support plans they need?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, neither John or his son should be put in that position, and I will write to Mr Bibby around about that situation again. We want to see young people treated as quickly as possible, and we also want to put in place a system whereby there is not an over-reliance on acute services and that we can actually deal with things before they reach that stage. We are working very hard and have invested very heavily in CAMHS services. Obviously, there has been impact because of the COVID pandemic, but we are seeing progress, and I hope that continues, and I will write to Mr Bibby.
Question number six, Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that affordable housing development plans have been put on hold because of event fees.
Cabinet Secretary Shona Robison.
Scotland is significantly ahead of the rest of the UK in providing affordable housing, having delivered almost 113,000 affordable homes since 2007, over 79,000 of which were for social rent. We recognise the impact of interest rates and high material and labour costs, which is why we continue to operate a flexible grant system, which we expect will support the continued delivery of the affordable homes target. In advance of the emergency legislation, we set up a working group with social landlords to help assess the options to keep rents affordable for tenants beyond the 31st of March in the light of the cost of living crisis. That work is continuing, and during the passage of the bill, we further committed to giving clarity and certainty to social landlords on rent setting no later than the 14th of January.
Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, President. The Cabinet Secretary has failed to answer the question. Lord Willie Hawkey recently announced that his plans to spend more than £1 billion on building 11,000 affordable homes in Scotland was scrapped. Specifically, he said that because of Patrick Harvey's rent freeze bill, he would have to put things on hold. Does the Cabinet Secretary now recognise that the SNP government's rent freeze has made the housing crisis worse, not better, in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
What I certainly recognise is, once again, the laissez-faire attitude of the Tories opposing measures to help tenants with rent increases during a cost-of-living crisis. In the same way as the opposed measures to restrict the loss of housing to short-term holiday lets. No ideas, no solutions, just opposition for opposition's sake. And yet they refuse to take responsibility for the disastrous economic policies of the Tory government leading to high interest rates.
We will hear the Cabinet Secretary.
Leading to high interest rates, which is the biggest impact on the social rented sector and the affordable housing supply programme at this moment in time. Total hypocrisy, as ever, from the Tories.
Question number 7, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its consultation on a new agricultural bill.
Minister Mary McCallum.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government launched our consultation entitled Delivering Our Vision for Scottish Agriculture Proposals for a New Agriculture Bill on the 29th of August. The consultation closes on the 21st of November and all members of the public are encouraged to submit responses. Alongside the consultation, we're hosting a number of events to hear views from across the country on what needs to feature in the future bill to transform how we support farming and food production in Scotland to become a global leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Presiding Officer, yesterday hundreds of farmers and a handful of tractors rallied outside Parliament to highlight the issues facing farmers across Scotland. They feel let down by an SNP Green coalition that simply does not understand their concerns. Their disdain for the Bute House agreement was especially clear. Given the views expressed by farmers yesterday...
Can we please hear Ms Hamilton?
Given the views expressed by farmers yesterday, does the Minister agree with me that her Green coalition partners have no understanding of the needs of rural Scotland?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I'm not really even sure where to begin with that question, except to say that farmers and food producers in Scotland are quite right to come to this Parliament to speak to representatives here. And the fact of the matter is that while I stand here answering this question, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs is right now with the Agriculture Reform Implementation Oversight Board, proactively engaging with industry to design future policy. And, you know, whether it's Brexit, whether it's utter economic incompetence, or with their complete refusal to listen
members,
to industry,
thank you.
It is the Members' Party in government who are repeatedly and profoundly letting down Scotland's food producers.
Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It absolutely never ceases to amaze me when the Tories try to promote themselves as the party standing up for farmers. They can say what they like about the concern and the support for agriculture, but where was that support and concern when they opposed this Parliament withholding consent to the Subsidy Control
Thank
Act?
Thank you.
The hypocrisy is utterly galling. The NFUS were clear in expressing concerns about the potential impact of this legislation on farmers. It could have profound and fundamental impact on our ability to tailor support to the specific needs of Scotland's farmers, which you're supposed to represent. So does the Minister agree with me that while the other parties can be relied upon to play politics, when it comes down to the facts, the SNP can be relied upon to safeguard the interests of Scottish agriculture and deliver on those interests?
Minister.
Presiding officer, I completely agree with Jim Fairley. The inclusion... A very, very useful voice for the farming industry in the Parliament. But the inclusion of
members,
agriculture...
Minister. Members, can we make sure that we hear all members when they're speaking? Thank you.
Presiding officer, the inclusion of agriculture support in the scope of the UK Subsidy Control Act is both unnecessary and risks undermining the agriculture support framework. Farmers and crofters in Scotland face challenges which are not found elsewhere in the rest of the UK, and yet this constrains our ability, this Parliament's ability, to develop future policies that are tailored to meet them. However, we remain fully committed to delivering our vision for agriculture, implementing a framework that delivers both high-quality food production and empowers Scotland's farmers and food producers to play their very important role in mitigating climate change and supporting nature recovery in Scotland, and we will get on with that job.